I'm with Richard Tenaza, president of the National.
That's the funds, Filipino American National Historical Society, Stockton chapter only. It's a national organization.
Wrong name. Tell us about the history of Filipinos in Stockton.
Well, the Filipinos started coming to Stockton in the early 1900s. The biggest wave was the 1920s, and they were coming to work in the fields. And even if some of them didn't know it, they thought they were coming to better things. Almost all of them ended up working in the fields around Stockton. So there were several thousand by the 1940s. In the 1934, the government issued an order that the Philippines was going to get independence in 1946, which meant the Filipinos could no longer freely immigrate because there was a lot of hostility and competition too, because the Dust Bowl was going on, all the problems in Oklahoma and elsewhere, and people moving here. So there's competition for menial labor between the poor whites and Filipinos. And so there's a lot of aggression around that. A lot of all through the 1930s. Right here in Stockton, the Filipino Federation building was bombed at about 1930, and there were anti-Filipino riots all over California and Washington State too. Not all over California, the agricultural areas. So what else can I tell you? That's what was going on in the 1930s. Some Filipinos took advantage of the government's offer to send them back to the Philippines free if they'd sign a paper saying they'd never come back here again. And a few hundred left, but the majority stayed. And when World War II started, it run in a different era because Filipinos wanted to join the military but couldn't. And eventually some special regiments, all Filipino, were established, first and second Filipino regiments. And they went to the Philippines and New Guinea and fought. And that kind of relieved some of the tension. The Filipinos were fighting for America. And a lot of them ended up in the Philippines. And immigration had essentially been cut off. But the Filipino soldiers going to the Philippines were marrying local women there, a lot of them, and bringing them back here as war brides. And so this was kind of another wave of immigration, because among the early immigrants in the 1920s, mainly, it was about 15 to 1. There were 15 males for one female. And so there were a few women around. And there were anti-miscegenation laws that prohibited Filipinos from marrying white women. And my mother was white, my father was Filipino. But they could not get married in California. They had to go to Washington State. All the states contiguous with California established the same laws California did. So one could not get married in Arizona or Oregon or Nevada. They had to go to New Mexico, Utah, and Washington State. My parents went to Washington, which was the closest to Northern California. So that was kind of an aside. Back after the war, then Second World War, then more Filipino women were coming in, and some of the hostility towards Filipinos and a lot of them, before that, they were not allowed to become citizens. Filipinos were not allowed to be citizens of the U.S. But with the, all those the thousands that joined the Filipino regiments were allowed citizenship. They had a mass naturalization of, I don't remember, a few thousand Filipino soldiers all at the same time. So for the first time, there were Filipinos who were now Filipino Americans, who are citizens of the U.S. So that brings us up to World War II, and I was born in that era, 1939, and so after. Oh, during the war, another thing the Filipinos did, the Filipino men, besides some continued work in the fields, but there was a need for them in war industries, especially in shipbuilding. So during World War II, a lot of Filipino men, including my father, went to work in the shipyards. My father was working in Bethlehem Steel in South San Francisco. And after the war was over, it was kind of back to the fields again. And at least for my family and a lot of others. So, but you're going to edit this, right? And a lot of the, Filipinos were coming in my father's era. A lot of them came with, most of them had very little education. My father went to about the fourth grade at school, and that was the majority. They were coming from agricultural provinces in the Philippines. They weren't coming from Manila. So they were mainly from poor farming families, and they came up here to become poor farm workers. But after the war, people were, those that had kids, because a lot of them didn't. A lot of Filipino men never married because no women. And they were urging kids to go on and do other things, maybe go to college or go into various blue-collar professions other than farm work. And that's the way it was up until the 1960s. In 1964, President Johnson signed an immigration bill that suddenly allowed 20,000 Filipinos per year to come into the U.S. But it was a different kind of Filipino, sort of. Instead of the poor rural peasant farmers, the people that were coming in were better educated, more affluent families, because they were being recruited for that. We needed doctors, nurses, engineers, architects. So the big influence of highly educated, more affluent Filipinos in the 1960s, which led to some interesting problems, because we had to delineate the kind of poor pioneers, and then suddenly the better educated, more affluent group come in the 1960s.
Did they come out? Did that group tend to come to Stockton, or did they stay in the Bay Area?
All over the U.S.
Los Angeles, all over.
Okay. Yeah. And actually, during the time the Filipinos were coming to Stockton and Washington State to work in the fields, they were in the 1920s. Other Filipinos were going to the eastern U.S. And I know less about them.
What are some of the big communities outside of California?
Los Angeles has a big community. San Francisco, of course. Daly City is about, I think it's over 40% Filipino, if I'm not mistaken. And otherwise, the Filipinos are kind of scattered. That's the second largest, as I recall, Asian American group in America after Chinese. I believe. I don't have all these things ingrained pulling my mind. But there are, big communities scattered around the country.
Well, talk about the museum. What's the idea behind the museum here in Stockton?
The museum in Stockton is supposed to be a National Museum of Filipino American History, and it's under the umbrella of funds. And so right now it's kind of the formative stages still. And we have an opening date scheduled for October, kind of an open house on October 8th, and then an official opening on October 29th. And again, it's supposed to be national in scope, but we have a very small facility, and we'll cover it nationally, but in very small exhibits until hopefully in the future we'll go into something more elaborate.
Does the museum have like a mission statement or something that motivates people? You'd like to see people come there and gain from visiting the museum?
Well, essentially educate the public about Filipino American history. Goal of the organization, and the history and the accomplishments, what Filipinos are doing now, not only in the old days. And it's a pretty broad-ranging community. Like here today, in Stockton, we've had Filipino American medical groups and Filipino American biker groups, as one represented here, and Filipino American Lions Club, and Filipino sport groups. There are all kinds of Filipino American groups in in Stockton, covering a wide range of interests and professions. And you should talk to bikers too. You think a lot of people see the bikers and sometimes get kind of start cringing, but if you talk to them, you find out that people know all kinds of professions there, and it's a nice bunch of people. They just we have kind of a stereotype notion of what bikers are about, which in this case is not true. Are you going to go talk to them?
I am.
Okay, sure.
Hey, Larry, or Richard, thank you so much.
I hope you do some good editing on that.